in their historical habitat. The theory of the alien invasion, or as it is now called, immigration, states that at some unspecified time, the Indo-Iranians, who formed then one unit, moved from Kurgan, which is the South Russian or Pontic steppe. They moved down by the Caucasus Mountains through Iran. They stayed for a southeast Iran. And then the Indo-Aryans, that's the Indians, your ancestors, moved away from there and came and inhabited Sapta Sindhu, the land of the seven rivers in northwest India and what is today India and Pakistan. And there you have, in fact, the languages and the main idea about the alien invasion theory. This happened around about 1700 or 1500. Now, any sensible person will ask, how was the Sapta Sindhu Aryanized, Sanskritized? Because the theory changed after 1995 and became, in the West, they say that this immigration happened over a long period of time, several years, perhaps 200 years, with small waves of Aryans coming into that area, which we call Sapta Sindhu. Now, around about 3700, the Harappan culture was beginning to arise in that area, in Saraswati and the Indus valleys. And by 3000, it began to develop quite considerably, and it reaches its mature state around about 2700, 2800, 2600 BCE. Now, how could very small waves of people, 200, 100, 300, small waves that left no archaeological traces whatsoever, how could they Aryanize that area? That area is as large as France and Germany put together. So how was Sanskrit spread all over that area? There was no Ministry of Education, there were no mass media. So how did this happen? These are questions that are not answered by the AIT. They just talk glibly about it, they slide over it, they pass it on from one generation to another, but they never explain these things. And unfortunately, students are not sufficiently acute to question them and say, how does this happen? Lord Colin Renfrew, who was an archaeologist, said that the notion comes rather from a historical assumption about the coming of the Indo-Europeans who spread into Europe. Therefore, the Indo-Europeans spread into India also. Then Edmund Leach, a great anthropology, provost of King's College at Cambridge, said, because of their commitment to a unilateral segmented history of language development that needed to be mapped onto the ground, the philologists took it for granted that Proto-Indo-Iranian was a language that originated outside India and Iran, in Kurgan. From this we derive the myth of the Aryan invasion. These are Western scholars, but they are not linguists. One is an anthropologist, the other is an archaeologist. It's linguists that have concocted this idea, paying no heed to what anthropologists say, no heed to what archaeologists say. In fact, they pay no heed even to linguistics themselves, as I shall show you shortly. Now, the arguments supporting the AIT now are, one, can I have the next one, please? Iranian is older than Vedic. Avestan, the old Persian language, is older than Vedic. Then there was palatalization. Palatalization is showing at the end Latin que, Greek kai, te, Vedic becomes cha. And this applies wherever you find qu in Latin or Greek, you find a corresponding cha in Sanskrit. This was called palatalization. It is shared with Slavonic languages and Baltic languages. I don't want to baffle you, but one has to touch on these linguistic facts. Then the third argument is that Vedic is a mixture of Munda and Dravidian with Indo-Aryan. But that doesn't say anything about an invasion. The fact that Sanskrit has got some Munda or Dravidian words in it, if it has, it's not proven, but assume that it does so. It doesn't give you any date, and it certainly doesn't give you an invasion. Then there are isoglosses. I shall come to isoglosses later and explain what they are. But briefly now, we can say that in palatalization, an isogloss is a distinctive feature that joins together a group of languages or a group of dialects. As I said, palatalization is shared by Sanskrit, by Slavonic, and by the Baltic languages. Greek, Latin, German does not have palatalization. So one group is put apart against the others. Isoglosses differentiate between languages. Also, ma, me. Vedic has for prohibitions ma. Greek has me. Old Iranian has also ma. Armenian has mi. But Germanic has na. Slavic has na. Celtic has na. So again, we have an isogloss that separates different languages. The other great argument is horses and chariots. There are not enough horse remains in Harappan cities, the linguists say. Therefore, since the Aryans brought horses, horses should appear afterwards. That's why we have very few horse remains in Harappan cities. Then chariots also are not there. Chariots were invented round about 18 or 1900 BCE, some at Andronovo and some at Egypt. Now, all this is utter and absolute nonsense. If they don't have a leg to stand on, as I shall demonstrate shortly. Next one, please. Now, the Aryan immigration theory is supposed to be a linguistic one. It isn't. It did not start like that, and it had nothing to do with Aryans. Before, in the beginning of the 18th century, some Frenchmen and some English scholars tried to explain the peculiar caste system which they found in India. How does this come about? Now, if they looked at their own history, medieval history, they would have seen that there were castes in Europe as well, equally hereditary, not as pronounced, not as institutionalized as they are in India, but they were there. Anyway, they wanted an explanation. So what did they come up with? They came up with a sociological theory that the Egyptians invaded Sapta Sindhu and established themselves there. And the Egyptian priesthood became the Brahmanas, the Egyptian warriors became the Kshatriyas, and the native population became the Vaishyas and the Shudras. This, some thought it was not the Egyptians, it was the Sumerians. Even at that time, they couldn't agree between them. But anyway, well, there are the, I won't bother you with all these names, I'll come to Max Müller, who actually introduced the linguistic element. However, neither linguistic data provide evidence for an invasion or a date of 1700, nor horses and chariots. Let's deal with horses first. Now, if the Aryans came in and brought horses, then after 1500, we should have masses of horse finds all over Sapta Sindhu. In fact, there is none. There are no significant archaeological finds of horse remains until these first centuries of the new current era, after Christ, in other words. Do you follow? There is no significant increase of horse remains anywhere. So how can we say that the Aryan invasion brought horses in? If they had brought horses in, there should be more, but there aren't. The same applies to chariots. Chariots, the first remains of chariots are from 300 BCE. We don't have any chariots before that. There are no finds archaeologically. Next one, please. Next one. Now, chariot translates the word ratha. Now, as you see, ratha is made from the dhatu r, which gives you the stem ra, plus the termination ta, and you've got other terminations, artha, ukta, gata, and so on. So, ratha means a goer. It's a cart. It's something that moves on wheels. It has nothing to do with chariots, as you see them in films in ancient Egypt, or in ancient Rome, or in ancient Greece. But the heritage of classical education made scholars in the 19th century translate the word ratha as chariot. In fact, anybody who knows Sanskrit and has studied MacDonnell's Vedic reader will notice that MacDonnell in his Vedic reader does not translate ratha not once as chariot. He always uses the word car. He was a sensible scholar. Now, the rathas are described as made of native timber. There they are. They are described as being prithu. Now, a war chariot is not prithu. It's a narrow box, big enough only to hold the charioteer and the warrior with his spear and his bow and arrows. That's all. So there were two places. But what do we find? The Vedic chariot is described as trivandhura, three spaces. And there is one ashtavandhura, eight spaces. It's really a minibus. It carries a lot of people. It has nothing to do with war chariots at all. And when one reads the Rig Veda, one finds that chariots are drawn mostly by oxen. The one realistic description of a chariot race, as they call it, is Mudgala and Mudgalani. In the 10th mandala of the Rig Veda, their calf is drawn by a bull. Sometimes, very rarely, it's drawn by horses, and sometimes by birds, the Ashwin chariot in the sky is drawn by birds, and sometimes by antelopes. So it has nothing to do with war chariots as are known in the West. Now, horses and chariots are really red herrings. So you find, you read the books talking about horses and chariots, you know the writer doesn't really know what he's talking about. Can we have the next one? Now the next one is a spoked wheel. For a long time, Western mainstreamers were shouting out, there are no spoked wheels in Saptasindhu, in the Harappan culture. But in fact, they discovered spoked wheels, first of all, on the sea from Kalibangan, and that they were identified as spoked wheels by Pakola, a Finnish scholar, an archaeologist, who was an invasionist, in fact. And then they were found these wheels in Kalibangan and Rakigahi, which is a very common practice to form out of terracotta a wheel and then paint the spokes on it. They found them up in Romania, as far as Romania. So it's not just an Indian feature. Next one, please. How did this extraordinary chronology of 1500 or 1700 arise? Well, it's Max Müller again. He said, 12 to 1000 Rigveda, 1000 to 800 Atharva and Yajus, 800 to 600 the Brahmanas, Sutras, and so on down to 200 BCE. Very neat, you see. Every 200 years, we've got something else. Now, it would have taken alone Shatapatha Brahmana, which is vast, 200 years to write. Just one Brahmana, let alone dozens of Brahmana. How did this arrive? Well, Max Müller read Katha Sarsaga. You know, this is a lovely, the ocean of stories. And among them, there is a ghost story, and there is a chap in that ghost story called Katyayana. So Max Müller, this Katyayana lived during the reign of a particular king. So Max Müller thought, this is Katyayana who wrote the sutras, the Sharauta sutras. So this king lived then, so that's Katyayana, 200 BCE. So he worked backwards. Let's give 400 years for the sutras, 200 years for the Brahmanas, the Upanishads, and so on and so forth. And he arrived at the date, miraculously, 1500. That's how it did. Based on one ghost story. Now, how many people know this? Well, I can tell you. Almost nobody. Because they don't read what Max Müller wrote. They just repeat this Aryan invasion theory quite mechanically, like monkeys, and they don't know what they're saying. There was another factor, the date of creation of the universe. When Max Müller was writing in the 1850s, Dyer's geological study, Dyer's geological studies had not yet gained currency, which he presented vast tracts of time. In Max Müller's day, and he was a devout Christian, they believed Bishop Ashers, an Irish archbishop, who said that having calculated the names of the great prophets in the Old Testament, that the creation began at 2004 BCE. He gave the exact date. So, in fact, any major change in ancient history had to fall within that bracket. So 1500, 1700 seemed reasonable. If we went much before that, it would have been difficult, because we would get involved with Jews and so on. So this is really how this structure was built, on two fictions, two entire fictions. And, you know, serious, mature, responsible scholars actually swallowed all this nonsense. I did too. For 18 years I taught this theory. But I never bothered to read proto-history of India. It was only when I started reading archaeologists and historians that I began to realize that something was wrong. Next one, please. Now, this is the linguists. Please read it so that I don't get tired and my mouth gets dry. Well, there you have it. The article by George Davis in the Scientific American revolutionized Indology. There was no invasion. So the linguistic arrogance of these linguists was shown to be just that. Now, observe that Eminor talks about a linguistic doctrine. He talks about arguments. He does not talk about evidence, facts, data. And he has the arrogance to say the traditional Hindu ignorance of this invasion. Now, who was ignorant? The Hindu tradition or he himself? And the same, of course, with Barrow. Now, he was a great Sanskritist, Barrow, there's no doubt about it, but he was an awful historian. People, linguists, just linguists, not historians. A. Basham, who wrote The Wonder That Was India, you know the book, you've heard of the book. Now, he immediately after Davis changed his views, immediately. Because he was a historian, and he recognized historical facts. He was not, he knew Sanskrit, of course, but he was not a linguist. He didn't have linguistic training. But linguists persisted with their invasion until 1995. A book by Wynne from Columbia in New York, I can't remember the title, but he went on talking about invasion and conquest and enslaving the local population and all the rest of the rubbish. Next one, please. Now, you all know of the Rig Veda, even though you may have not read it. You've heard of it, yes? So I don't need to tell you what it is. The Rig Veda consists of 10 mandala, 1,028 hymns. It's a fairly thick book. But in all this book, you will not find these things. You will not find those words that I say, the words. You will not find iconography, you will not find perforated jars, you will not find mention of ruins or abandoned towns, and you will not find mention of fixed altars or hearths. So, what does that tell us? Now, all these features are in the Harappan civilization. In the mature Harappan civilization. The most important of the lot is the Ishtaka. The others are all equally important, but Ishtaka is really setting a limit. Because Ishtaka's bricks for building started being used around about 3,500, 3,700. Before that, it was mud and stone and wood. Just as in the Rig Veda. You find mention of Istakas in Yajurveda and in the Brahmanas. They describe altars in different shapes built with Istakas. Urbanization is wholly absent in the Rig Veda. There is, of course, Pur, but Pur in the Rig Veda never means a city or a fortress as is usually translated. Never, not once. It means an internal, supernatural, occult defense. And you have only gods creating and destroying these pools. Well, I will not enumerate all of them because it would take us a long time. But you can take my word for it. I'm sure there's Professor Das here who will back me up on this, that these words are not in Rig Veda. You don't find Karpasa, which is cotton. You don't find Rajata, except once, and it doesn't mean silver. It means bright white. You don't find Vrihi, and you don't find Godruma, wheat. You don't find Lekha or Lipi for writing. And you certainly don't find the rest of them. There is the word Armaka, that's true. It's often translated as ruins, but if you read that hymn 133, you'll find that it does not refer to ruins. It refers to a desolate area, a countryside, where there are sorcerers, magicians, demonic spirits and ghouls and that sort of thing. There is no mention of stone slabs, there is no mention of rafters, there is no mention of bricks or anything to suggest fallen houses.
Could you please repeat that
pur? Pur, what it means? It means an internal, supernatural, divine, occult defense. I've written a paper, a very long paper, and I examine many, many instances and show that that's exactly what it is. And it takes a god to destroy it. Next one, please. Well, there you have the perforated pots. There's no mention of that in the Rig Veda, but there's plenty of it in Shatapada Brahman. Can we move on, please? Now, as you know, some Brahmanas comment on the Rig Veda. The Rig Veda refers very sparsely to various events, historical events, mythological events, we don't know. But we don't really know what's going on. And Brahmanas come along later and give us the story. So you've got the story of Shunashepa, which is mentioned in two or three verses only in the Rig Veda, but Aitareya Brahmana gives you the whole story, how the father offered his son as sacrifice, but the son, Shunashepa, gained the favor of the god Agni and was spared by god Varuna, and so on. Then you have the Pururavas and Durvashi, that beautiful hymn, a dialogue between the king Pururavas and the beautiful Apsaras Urvashi. But again, we don't know what the background is, we don't know what the plot of the story is, but Shatapada Brahmana comes along and tells us the story. And later on, Kalidasa wrote his magnificent play, Vikrama Urvashiyam. Then there are many stories in the Rig Veda that we know absolutely nothing about. There was, for instance, the story of Buju. He's mentioned as being lost at sea, and the Ashwins come along with their chariot. They pick him up. You see, I've grown used to using the word chariot myself. With their car, they pick him up and drive him to dry land. What's the date of the Brahmanas? Now, why would the Brahmanas feel the need to fit in all these stories. Well, there's only one reason really you do that. You start writing down something when you feel that it's being lost. So by the time of the Brahmanas, these stories were lost. That's why you don't have anything about Buju. But the other stories, something remained and the Brahmanas preserved it. Now, when is the date of the Brahmana? Well, various calculations have been done. Narahari Achar, the professor of astrophysics in Memphis, United States, places them around about 3,000. There was another scholar, Raghavan, he 60 years ago, he also came to the, he had also come to the same conclusion. Subhash Kak also made some calculations. He's another scientist, an Indian scientist in the United States. I think he's in Oklahoma now. He used to be in Baton Rouge. He's Oklahoma, yes? Yes. Yeah. He also came to the conclusion 2900 BCE. So, the Rig Veda must be a lot earlier than, say, 3000. Let's look at the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. Next one, please. Now, the main teaching of the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, as with other Upanishads, is that I am Atma Brahma. This self of man is the same as the Brahman, the absolute, the self of the universe. But it is known that there was an Upanishadam Purusham teaching. I asked about the Upanishadic person. That's in 3926 in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. So there was a long tradition. The Brihadaranyaka appears as a unified Upanishad, but in fact, after book 2, there is a list of teachers. After book 4, there is another list of teachers, and after book 6, there is another list of teachers, which suggests that there were three different traditions that were joined up and formed the unified Upanishad that we know today. So let's take one list of 60 teachers, give each teacher an average of 15 years, although 20 or 30 might be more correct, more realistic. Now, if we multiply 60 by 15, it gives us 900. Now, the Upanishads, the early Upanishads, like Brihadaranyaka, is placed in the 6th century by mainstream Western scholarship. So, give it a date, 550. Plus 900, which gives us the tradition behind that, we get 1450 years. Let's say it's not 1450 years, let's say it's 1200 years, okay? Now, the Rig Veda is supposed to be written at 1200 years. Not one of